This morning you have paid $5 or even $6 for your coffee. Not so long ago, this money could buy your lunch. Bank just raised interest rate on your mortgage. Now each month you have to pay $1,000 or even $2,000 more. Your neighbors who live next to you for decades now have to move out because their landlord has increased rent, pricing them out of the neighborhood. Communities are being destroyed across the country. Politicians declare war on the rising cost of living. They tell us that everything is under control, that everything is going to be fine. Yet somehow our instincts tell us not to believe them. From now on, we will be living in a new world, the world of inflation. Inflation was an important part of my research in behavioral economics at Columbia University in New York, Humboldt University in Berlin, and later as a Forbes columnist in China. In the next decade, inflation will change the life of each one of us. Yet we, scientists, tech and IT people, somehow we still don't understand what is happening, what inflation is, and what does it mean for us. This is pound sterling, the currency of the UK. Sterling actually means silver. In Anglo-Saxon times, before the Norman invasion, they used silver coins called sterlings. And 1 pound sterling literally meant 1 pound of sterling coins. Do you know how much silver you can buy with 1 pound of sterlings now? 1/300 of a pound. Those who held pound of sterling under the mattress have lost more than 99% of their value. Similar story happened in the US. Since 1970s, when the US dollar was pegged to gold at $35 per ounce, the dollar has lost 98.8% of its value, if we measure it in gold. What happened to that disappeared value? Where did it go? This is a car engine. It has many moving parts which need lubrication. This is why mechanics added machine oil, and if you don't put enough oil, the engine stops. So, in our little analogy, economy is an engine, and money is oil. It is the government's or the central bank's job to ensure that there is enough oil, that the economy has enough money. Government is a mechanic. When the economy grows, or when the engine becomes bigger, more oil is needed. So the government adds some oil, prints some money. But if the government puts too much oil, pressure rises. This is how the price of your morning coffee goes up. It's inflation. So too much oil is a bad thing. But interestingly, some people benefit from it. When the government prints money, it is actually getting some valuable goods in return. For government, printing money costs nothing. It's free money. This is called seigniorage. Excessive money then goes to real estate and stock markets, and prices rise. And the government considers that rise as a profit and tax it. So the government benefits from inflation in at least two ways, seigniorage and taxation. Now, wealthy owners of those houses and stocks, they enjoy the rising prices, and they become even wealthier. Have you ever heard any complaints about inflation from wealthy house owners? Me neither. Now let's take a look at the labor providers, or in other words, workers, those who have to work every day to survive. That's basically most of us. When the price of our coffee goes up, our salary usually stays fixed. Ask anybody who tried to negotiate a salary increase recently. So if you look at it from this perspective, effectively inflation is a tax on working class, on working people. However, somehow most people don't see a connection between inflation and government printing money. If you watch the news, inflation is reported as if it were a rain, a hurricane, or an earthquake, a natural disaster of some sort. They blame supermarket chains, speculators, greedy producers. They blame anybody except the government.
We also received encouraging news today on inflation.
It is an incredible psychological phenomenon, a paradox. People simply do not associate inflation with the government, which is why governments love it so much. After 1980s, the US economy, the engine, was growing steadily. The government was adding just a little bit of machine oil, money. And inflation, which you can see here in the form of a coffee cup, was floating somewhere around 2-3% per year most of the time. Here on this chart, blue line is money printed, monetary-based, called officially. And the red line with coffee cup is inflation, or CPI index, expressed in the price of one cup of coffee. For some time, everything was smooth. The inventions of personal computers and internet made the economy grow, so the engine was getting bigger and the government was printing just a bit of money, and everything was nice and smooth. And then a remarkable thing happened. Boom! 2008 crisis. To fight it, the government decided to print money, lots of money. But as you can see, a very strange thing happened. Inflation didn't follow. Then another crisis, COVID. The government used to say the same solution, printing money. And this time, inflation went up, but just a little bit. This little bump here, you see, this is that extra dollar that you paid for your coffee this morning. Look at this chart. Somehow the government increased printed money from 800 billion to almost 6 trillion. This is almost 8 times increase. But can you see inflation? Somehow it went up just a few percent. This is an anomaly. But we need to understand it if we want to know what inflation has for us in future. So, how did the government manage to keep inflation low? The answer will have three parts. First, globalization. It has started in mid-2000s, and this is when global trade has boomed. Interestingly, although the share of the United States in the global trade is just around 12%, the share of the American dollar in global trade is very high. For example, almost 50% of all international trade payments are made in dollars. 87% of all exchange transactions are done in US dollars too. The dollar was the currency of the world trade. No matter what cross-border transaction you ran, in most cases you needed US dollars. We can think of it as if the engine of the world economy was running on the US dollar oil, and the whole world has become the engine for America. And as globalization picked up steam in mid-2000s, this growing engine absorbed a lot of US dollars. Second, Chinese export. As you may remember, it was around mid-2000s when almost everything around us suddenly got a label made in China. The US government opened the doors wide to Chinese export. In exchange, China received critical technologies that took US decades and trillions of dollars to develop. Because of this technology transfer, China could give a discount and was selling its product at a very low price. Cheap Chinese products pushed inflation down, well, and also killed US manufacturing, but that's a story for another video. By the way, don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss it. At the peak, China was selling more than $500 trillion worth of cheap goods per year. The government exchanged American technologies for low inflation. And now finally, the third and the most important one, debt. Most of the time, the US government was paying for everything not with money, but with debt. Technically, debt is money, but it's future money which can't be used now. So, going back to our analogy, engine analogy, when you pay with debt, you are not adding oil into the engine. Instead, you put it into a fridge. Debt does not create inflation now. It creates inflation later. It pushes it into the future, to the next generations. How much debt was created? Here, follow the blue line. $34 trillion. But is it a lot? We need to put it into comparison to figure out if it's a lot or not. Let's compare it to the size of the entire US economy, the size of the engine. Here, this red line on this chart, it's a debt per GDP, where GDP is basically the size of the engine, and debt is the size of our fridge. So in the past, government debt was usually about 50% of the economy. Today, it is 1.2 times larger than the economy. The fridge has become 1.3 times larger than the engine. Globalization, cheap Chinese products, and debt. With these three tools, the US government managed to keep inflation down, to keep the engine running. And then, February 2022 happened.
Russia has invaded Ukraine.
Russia's full-scale invasion of Ukraine.
Putin's invasion in Ukraine triggered a chain reaction of events. The US has tried to use its monopoly as a weapon and sanctioned Russia, cutting it off from the US dollar payment system. But then it turned out that all this time, China has been quietly building its own global payment system. And Russia simply switched from dollar to yuan. The share of yuan in global trade went from nothing to almost 5%. What it means is that the war in Ukraine has revealed that US no longer has a monopoly in the global trade payments. The world has suddenly learned that now trade can be done in yuan too. And because literally everything is made in China, replacing dollar with yuan is not going to be a very difficult task. It will be very quick. And those excessive dollars, where do they go? Yes, that's right, they are returning back to the US engine. And these returning dollars are already pushing up inflation. So we can remove the globalization from the list of tools that kept inflation low. And now let's take a look at the cheap Chinese products. Putin's invasion created a tremendous amount of tension between US and China. It started so-called China decoupling, in other words, a full-scale trade war. The flow of the cheap Chinese products is now disrupted, and as the war escalates, Chinese products disappear from the US shelves. Okay, maybe not that dramatic, but, well, you got the point. Of course, the Chinese products will be replaced, but the replacement goods from other countries or manufactured in the US, they will be much more expensive. The price for the US consumers will go up. And that will create, that's right, even more inflation. And now the most interesting part, the US debt. As we saw, the US government has borrowed $34 trillion. But there is a little problem. This debt is not free. The government has to pay interest on it. Yes, previously it was almost free, because inflation was low, interest rates were close to zero, so paying interest was manageable. But as we all understand, interest rates cannot be lower than inflation. Indeed, who would agree to lend money at a rate below inflation, right? As inflation goes up, interest rates goes up too. And that creates something called the hyperinflation snowball. Let's take a look. This is the current budget of the US government. Income is $5 trillion and all expenses are $6.9 trillion. The government already spends almost $2 trillion more than it earns. An equivalent of this would be a person who each month earns $10,000 but spends $14,000. Interest payments are $0.8 trillion. Here you see a red block. This is how much interest US government pays now. Currently, interest rate is around 2.5%. Let's take a look at what happens if we increase the interest to 3.1%, which is the level of the current inflation. Here, it rises to more than $1 trillion. And now, at 8%, interest payment becomes bigger than all social programs, Medicare and Medicaid combined. If you think that 8% is an extreme level that cannot happen, don't forget that in 1980s, inflation was more than 14%. 14%. If tomorrow inflation and interest rates go to 14%, interest payments, just interest payments alone, will exceed the entire US government income. Is there a way out? There are only three ways: by reducing expenses, by increasing income, or by printing money. But reducing expenses is not realistic. The debt is so big that to compensate for interest rate or inflation hike, the government would have to make dramatic, enormous reductions in funding defense and social security. And that would be a political suicide for any government office. To make the matter worse, AI extinction waves are coming. As you have seen from our previous video here, and actually here, this AI extinction waves will eliminate 25% of the jobs within the next 10 years. And those will not be just drivers or call center operators. No, this will be finance and banking jobs, lawyers, doctors, HR, management roles. The well-paid professions are about to disappear. And the problem is that more than half of the US government income comes from tax on the personal income. And if 25% is eliminated by AI, government will lose a very substantial portion of its income. AI will take it. So, in this situation, the only viable option left on the table is printing money or borrowing more. The problem here is that it creates a hyperinflation snowball. If you pay with printed money, inflation pushes interest rates and payments up, and the next year you will need to print even more money. It's a snowball, and once triggered, it will start rolling. And we will enter the world of coffee for $15, $20 or even $30 per cup. When the hyperinflation will happen? When will the snowball start rolling? Well, it is hard to say now, because the world has never been in a situation like this before. But one thing is certain, once the snowball starts rolling, it will be nearly impossible to stop. Is there a way out? Can the hyperinflation catastrophe be avoided? Is there anything that can balance the situation and get the inflation snowball under control? Well, yes. And ironically, this is where science will have to step in. As we have seen, in the past, technological revolutions made the economy grow. As the engine grows, it needs more oil, more money. Presently, there are two main technologies that are almost ready to revolutionize the world to drive the next industrial revolution of a scale comparable to the invention of computer or internet. These technologies are AI and private space exploration. They will make the economy, the engine, so much bigger that the current level of money would be simply absorbed by the economy. The engine will grow and the snowball will not be triggered. In my personal opinion, this is the only feasible way of stopping the hyperinflation snowball. But to save us, the AI and space technological revolutions must start now. We are running out of time. The snowball is coming. We, scientists, tech and IT people, we need to speed up the technological revolution to make the engine bigger so it can absorb all this extra money printed. This is our historical mission, to drive the technological revolution, to save the world. Okay, you'll say, saving the world, that's great. But who's gonna save us? And yes, that's right. First, get an oxygen mask for yourself and then for people around you. If you ask my opinion, there are three things each one of us can do to protect from hyperinflation. First, if you rent and don't have a property, buy it now. Find a way to get that down payment and buy it now. Because once the snowball begins to roll, house prices will go to the orbit. And if our analysis is correct, soon it will be 10 times more difficult to buy a house. Second, if you have a mortgage with a variable rate, interest rate, switch to fixed rate. Otherwise, your bank will simply raise your rate as inflation goes up. And finally, if it so happens that you have some spare resources, then buying an investment property might be a good idea. Assuming you do not overpay for it, you may upgrade yourself from a working class to a wealthy class. And hyperinflation will no longer work against you, but for you. So you will be able to relax and continue saving the world comfortably while enjoying your $30 soy latte. Thank you for being with the Scripted channel. Subscribe so you don't miss the next videos. See you on the other side.